test. Hot take it coming. Veronica, how are you watching it again? Can you watch it on TV now? I only just watched it in the cinema today. Hot take. My hot take is the David Lynch one was way better. Is it true that Oscar Isaac is naked in this movie? I mean, not really. He is, but you don't see much apart from his like chest, I guess. But yeah, I want to talk about the politics of it. I haven't been keeping up on the conversation of the politics of it. I did see someone say it was a fascist film, which I found kind of weird. Because I don't think that's the message, but it reminds me of when people start saying Blade Runner 2049 was sexist because the dystopia was sexist or some shit like that. And it's like, the dystopia is sexist, yes, but this is a dystopia. It's not like your ideal society. Oh, I'm well tired though. Stayed up all night doing that fucking Chris Pratt video. After I played football and I was already tired from football, so. So it depends on some music quick. Let's go for this. Out the chat. Lawrence of Arabia is similar to Dune. Okay, so then Dune is white savior then, because that's what I said in my little points about it. Paul is not here. Okay, no one. Okay, here's another thing. No one spoil the book for me. Because I want to have my own opinions on it. Okay. You said that, Diego. I read that. release the... that's a famous iced coffee. Now, the only thing... it's just this white mocha or mocha powder you can buy. So I just made a nice coffee out of it, basically. I made a really, really strong one by accident on Sunday, and I was just, like, so excited. I also want to talk about the politics of Call of Duty. I'm going to make a video on it on Friday. It's actually really interesting because, like, I know this sounds like it should be every World War II game, but it is a pretty much, like, fuck Nazis World War II game, which isn't the most common considering Battlefield essentially made a World War II game, so I want to talk about that as well. Stop trying to force politics into Dune, the SJWs. I mean, yeah, I really haven't been keeping up on the conversation. It's actually a criticism of the white savior narrative. Okay. They did omit a part of the book that would have made Paul look bad, okay. Who wrote Dune? Like, what's their background? I literally don't know anything about it apart from seeing the film today. And I don't really want to know about... because I got my own theories about stuff that, like, it's fun. it's fun to not know stuff, like, so I can watch the film and not get it towards me. Although some fucking guy who tweeted that Dune was like the least, no, I broke my glasses, least humorous film he's ever seen. He did say, he did spoil the entire movie for me before I'd even seen it, which was nice. And I know I would have had a better experience if I didn't have it spoiled for me. Is that one of these? Oh, for fuck's sake, I got glue them again. I got to order so much new shit, man. Like, do you guys ever get to the point of, like, you don't spend money for ages and you think it's all going well, and then just everything starts breaking at the same time? Like, my mattress right now is just the fucking worst, and I don't want to spend it for a new mattress. So I bought a mattress topper, and I thought, like, I thought it would fix my bed, because I went for the expensive one. I was like, okay, I'll buy the expensive one, because if I buy the cheap one and it's crap, I'll be really annoying myself. So I bought the expensive one, and it's still fucking crap. And I was like, damn it, like, all these springs in my bed. And then my trainers broke, because the insoles I bought have been, like, digging into the back of them. So I need new shoes. And then I need my brother stepped on my nice glasses a while ago. I glued them back together, but then they've broken today. I've got these other ones. Kind of hurt, though. Like, again, it's just like I bought another pair because I don't sell those old ones that I really like, and then just buy a crap one for like 20 quid. Now I'm going to have to look for better ones. But yeah, I'm just like dreading. I'm going to have to like set aside like 500 quid to just like buy all the shit I need. I also need some stuff for YouTube. Like, I want to buy some capture card stuff. I moved to Spain in January for a couple months, so I want to get a portable monitor. So just gonna have a lot of costs, but hopefully I can get some tax write-offs for some of them, because I'm gonna register as self-employed this year. Chris Pratt video was fascinating. I mean, yeah, I always knew he was conservative. I didn't know he like exclusively followed like far-right political figures though. Hey Nick. COD Vanguard has politics. Yeah, I actually, like, they're subtle, but they are good politics, which is interesting. Okay. Well, no one spoiled the ending for me, please. Yeah, Blade Runner, I can understand why people would like Dune more than Blade Runner, but I think Blade Runner is stronger in pretty much every way, unless you enjoy spectacle a bit more. But like I said, I can understand people who enjoy Dune more. Oh, fuck it, I'll wear my other ones. These two are uncomfortable. I understand people who enjoy Dune more than it. It also depends on your relationship with the source material. Like, I like the book, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? I love the first movie, and then I love the second movie. But with Dune, I had no reference point. But what I did like is that I didn't have any reference point, but I still got really invested in this world just from the movie, which I think like shows the sign of like a really strong movie, in the sense that like I didn't understand the context of the world or what was going on or anything like that. So yeah, I really liked it. But Blade Runner, in my opinion, I think it's more focused, of course, because Dune is like this like big epic sci-fi thing with like loads of characters. So none of the characters really stand out too much. While I think Kay in Blade Runner, played by Ryan Gosling, is a better character, or at least even if you don't like his character as much, he's better acted and given more to do as this one person on this journey that only lasts for one film. Whereas even though like the performance in all these films is really like understated on purpose. It's like, there's no like big showy performance. I guess you could argue like Jared Leto maybe a bit in Blade Runner, but it's like no one's trying to win an Oscar for their performance in these movies, but they all just like become part of like the background and the story, which makes it more like realistic for Dune and Blade Runner. But I think Ryan Gosling in Blade Runner is better than anyone in both movies. I think because he's just given a bit more to do as the main character. I also like love the relationship between Ryan Gosling and Ana de Armas' like AI character as well. So I think that's like a more fun, well, they have better chemistry and a better dynamic, them two. So it makes it more enjoyable. Well, the Blade Runner world for me is something, And I just prefer it. Like, I that's the thing. Like, a lot of the times I'm willing to say, like, one thing is better than the other, but I just prefer Blade Runner a lot more because it's, like, stuff I, like, there's a whole, like, genre now with, like, Blade Runner synth and Blade Runner, like, aesthetics and stuff. Like, it's influenced so much about people who love this stuff that if you like these movies, you're really into the whole, like, scene of it. Whereas, like, with Dune at the moment, it's very cool and, like, really unique, but I just, like, I don't think about it a lot, and I've just seen it. I mean, I don't, like, think I'll be thinking about this much. Like, I'm listening to so I have this, like, Blade Runner soundtrack I'm listening to right now. It's the whole soundtrack, but it's, like, little movie bits cut in between, like, dialogue and stuff. When I was editing yesterday, I listened to the Blade Runner 2049 soundtrack and the first Blade Runner soundtrack. But I super love these movies so much. Like, literally one of my favourite things ever, you can probably see. So, I don't think Dune was ever going to top that. But, like, I don't necessarily love Denis Villeneuve's movies. Like, I didn't like Prisoners that much. Like, it was fine. I still need to see Arrival, because he's been good at sci-fi so far. But, Dune doesn't... The thing is, I'll give Dune credit. It doesn't feel like the first part of, like, maybe two films or three films. It's a very good movie just on its own, I think. And I really like the vagueness of it. And I wrote a whole article about this on my Medium page, about the vagueness of, like, Philip K. Dick, who wrote Man in the High Castle and the book Blade Runner is based on, and also the films, in that what I really like about world building is, like, you give me a look at something or you give me a glimpse, but you don't explain it to me. So, for example, in Blade Runner, you have things like Atari still existing in 2049, or like Pan Am. Obviously, these are dead companies now. And then you have things like the Soviet Union still existing in the Blade Runner world. And then just that little bit of information, you're just thinking about, like, what does this world look like beyond LA? And I really liked Dune for the same part. Like, those, that other tribe of, or house of people, the ones who kind of sounded like Norse people, like, they were wearing the white armor, and you just see, like, them all getting ready for battle. And that's, like, the only part of their planet you see, and, like, that's the only dialogue you hear with one of their leaders. And I like that a lot, because it just, like, shows you a little bit of what this world looks like outside of what you've seen. And then, like, you just left, you know, for your imagination to think about those things. And the thing is, people will then say, well, if you read the book, you would know X, Y, and Z. But someone also linked me some of this stuff, and I was like, I don't want to read that, because I want my imagination to imagine what these things are. And these characters might not even get expanded upon that much in the future films, and that's okay with me. Like, I can just imagine it. So I like that kind of storytelling a lot more. I just, I'm going to get into my Twitter thread about this, but, like, I guess the word is, like, tactile. It's, like, with both these films, Blade Runner and Dune, I can really imagine being in these universes. And I think it's because they take such time to, like, establish, like, even just watching people, like, use vehicles in it, like, they're all pressing, like, the buttons and doing certain things, so you get, like, an idea of how people fly them. So, like, I always appreciate taking time to do stuff like that, because it just makes me think about, like, how you can actually exist in these worlds. So I like both those movies for that reason. But for me, it's, like, you know, like, the cyberpunkness, the rain, the synth score, and, you know, that sort of stuff is why I like Blade Runner a lot more. Probably because it's also, like, a more realistic setting. I think it appeals to me. And, like, a setting that inherently has more political messaging in it, because it's not as abstract in terms of, like, you know, it's not set in the year 10,000 AD or whatever. But I really like both. Diego, I agree with you there. Dune is Game of Thrones, but instead of being shit and overrated, Dune is actually good. yeah, the thing is as well, like, with Dune, I will say, like, watching something on that scale, like the Star Wars scale, I did think when watching it, I was like, this is so much better than, like, any Star Wars movie. And I have a massive attachment to Star Wars. Like, I love Star Wars as a universe. Can you imagine, like, a Denis Villeneuve Dune-style Star Wars movie? Like, that would be so fucking good, man. Like, a real, like, self-contained thing, man. Like, it's just, like, when you're watching these movies for the first time, there's, like, there's a feeling I've had in both of them where it's, like, this is so good what I'm watching. I really don't have any major complaints of it. Like, it feels, like, satisfying to watch. Like, Blade Runner 2049 was probably the most satisfying experience I've ever had in a cinema, because I love the first one so much, but I went into it thinking, like, all right, like, The Star Wars movies massively let me down. Like, I was really disappointed walking out of them. There's other movies like you know, Last Jedi and Force Awakens. I was like, I'm not going to get my hopes up too much for this film. I'm just going to try and enjoy it. And then I went in, I was like, damn, like, that was so fucking good. That's like definitely in my top five already. And like such a nice sequel to the first one in that like it's nearly totally tying loose ends from the first movie. And I was like, it's so well done. Like, that's how you do a sequel to something that you release like for nearly 40, it's 40 years old next year, the first Blade Runner. And it just like takes what, and it's just like completely different aesthetic. And it's also like obviously influenced by modern politics. So like 2049 is more about climate change. I've talked about this a lot. People think it's not about climate change. Are you fucking ridiculous? Of course it is. Well, the first one's more about like corporate domination, like corporatism, and even some like racist connotations about the Japanese as well. But yeah, it's just it, both of them just like really really satisfying to watch. And just like, you can just, it's something really rare. Like, Christopher Nolan is like this blockbuster name who makes like more artistic movies, but I feel like Denis Villeneuve takes it even a step further, where it's like he's doing something in big budget films you just don't see anyone else do. Where it kind of used to be like Christopher Nolan, but Christopher Nolan kind of has like this very like kind of like framework he's working with now, where Denis Villeneuve's films are like all very, very different, and they just look amazing as well. Like the practical effects and like the miniatures he uses and everything, like from a technical standpoint, even if you don't like this movie, I think you really just have to admire what you're looking at. It's the same with Blade Runner as well. Like, just so much effort goes into all of it. You can really, that's the thing, like compared with Marvel movies, like I'm sure obviously like a lot of effort goes into Marvel movies, but something like this compared to a Marvel movie, it's just like night and day. Like, Marvel movies are basically like video game cutscenes at this point, with a lot of it obviously being done on green screen. And obviously a lot of Dune was probably filmed on green screen as well. I'm not saying it wasn't, but like if you watch how they made the second Blade Runner, it's, a lot of it is using miniatures like they used to do back in the day for like Indiana Jones and Star Wars and stuff. So it's just like, I don't know, seriously, it's just like something you just don't see these days. And I'm glad compared to Blade Runner did bad at the box office despite doing really well with critics, and I'm glad Dune has done well at the box office, because it's just like something, especially with sci-fi, which is obviously the thing with sci-fi, is it's such a popular genre, but there really isn't much good sci-fi out there. Like, Star Wars is decent in different forms, like Clone Wars is good, Mandalorian is good, that's kind of it for that stuff. And then you got some decent Star Treks, like older Star Treks, but the recent ones are more like hit or miss. And then, you know, it's weird that like Marvel are doing some interesting sci-fi stuff with like Loki and stuff like that. Like, it's weird, it's like Thor Ragnarok is doing more interesting and sometimes better sci-fi than like Star Wars, which is really bizarre. Obviously Taika Waititi also directed some Mandalorian. But yeah, no, I just, Roger Deakins did, Blade Runner. I'm gonna have a look who did Dune, though, because Roger Deakins also did 1917. One sec, let's get it up. Dune was, oh, just clicking the old one. Oh, come on, was there another one? There's another Dune movie, I didn't realise that, in 2000. So the cinematographer is Greg Fraser, who I haven't heard of, who did Rogue One and some Mandalorian. That's quite interesting, though. But I guess the sci-fi-ness is probably quite fitting. I will say the main thing, if I had one criticism of Dune, the soundtrack wasn't very memorable, apart from some certain parts of it. But, like, generally, I wouldn't go listen to it on my own. Like, I'm listening to the 2049 soundtrack right now. But it worked as part of the movie. Like, I'm not saying it was bad, but I didn't notice it much, for the most part. Rogue One is good. Yeah, I really like Rogue One. I'm hyped for the Cassian show, and I'm hyped for like the Obi-Wan show. I'm a big Star Wars simp. I know I shit on Marvel a lot, but the thing is with Star Wars, I'm not such a simp that I don't think Episode 9 is proper garbage. Because it is. Yeah, Nico, I get that. So the thing is, I was speaking to someone about this before, the Blade Runner 2049 soundtrack is so like unlike Hans Zimmer. Like, it's literally, I think, one of the most, apart from like, maybe the Rain Man soundtrack, like one of his first mainstream scores in the 80s, or like True Romance or something, where it's like these really weird synth scores. I'd say like Blade Runner is definitely the most unique one he's ever done, in that like if you played it for someone, I doubt they could even work out it was him. It's really not recycling any of his other stuff. I haven't watched Annihilation. Apparently it's fucking weird though. I did like Judge Dredd, which is Alex Garland as well. Revenge of the Sith, I mean, that was good enough. I love massacre scenes. The Doom one was quite good. Yeah, the first one does have climate change. Yeah, not as explicit for sure. To Harko, those are, a lot of those historical ones are pretty shit though. Like the last three you mentioned, 300, Rise of an Empire, and The Eagle. I'm glad it is solid though. Yeah, Dune is about imperialism, and Neuromancer is like one of the OG cyberpunk books, though, isn't it? Yeah, Kate, you used to see Blade Runner. I order you to see it. And if you haven't watched the first one in a while, go watch that again. Taylor Swift, well, she has a new documentary. Didn't she recently have one, like a year ago? Combat sites. Speaking of, I think God of War's combat is one of the best things about it. Good video on Chris Pratt. Thanks. I enjoyed making it to a degree, but like researching like his social media was like, oh damn. David, that's fucking funny, man. That would make it even worse for me. Yeah, Katie, the soundtrack for Rogue One, I don't actually rate that much, but it was also made in 6 weeks because the original composer, I forgot who it was. Someone I like was doing it, and then they dropped out like at literally last minute because the film's production was a mess. Who was the original composer of Rogue One? There was someone who did it, was doing it before. Okay, wait, it's a story. Oh, okay. I don't like the person who was doing it, so it doesn't really matter. But I don't know. It was okay. It was okay. Gonna watch The Last Duel, Kavernacle. Well, someone spoiled it for me. Apparently, it's quite good, though. All right, so I'll read you my opinion of Dune quick. I've got it up on the screen, so let's get into this. I've pretty much covered a lot of it, but you guys corrected me on the white saviour, so we'll see. But obviously, like I say in this, I haven't read the book, so how do I know? But I give it the benefit of the doubt. So gonna write my thoughts about Dune in this thread. So Blade Runner 2049 is my favourite film. And I haven't read Dune or seen the Lynch one, so I basically didn't know about it going in. It didn't eclipse Blade Runner for me, but it's a great movie. I also feel like there's a lot of similarities I like in both movies. I really enjoyed the performances from both films because they generally weren't very showy, but this helps the characters because become believable parts of the scenery. Obviously, Dune and Blade Runner have amazing casts. Yeah, Dune's cast is fucking amazing, by the way. Visually, Dune isn't like anything I've seen. Stylistically, it felt similar to Blade Runner at times, but I haven't seen sci-fi design like this. The ship designs are so unique, and I love the blend of like a modern military aesthetic with armor, swords, and knives. Yeah, it's really interesting. Like, the ships look so fucking weird in this movie, but in a good way. Like, those little helicopter things that look like dragonflies are really cool. And then the, like, big ships that look like worms. They literally look like the worms. Like, is it the Harkins ship or whatever they're called? And then just like the little like massive egg thing that the Emperor's like little servant comes to whatever their home planet is called. So the interior design is really nice too. I love how tactile everything in the world feels. I like how it takes the time to show the characters use equipment or press buttons, and I love the little things like Paul's ring light that follows him around. In terms of politics, okay, yeah, so this is where people were correcting me. This is what the vibe I'm getting, but I'm, you know, people have said that they've already taken out something that Paul does, which makes you not like him a bit. So let's go into this. So in terms of politics, I find them to be interesting, but I have mixed feelings. It's obviously a big critique of colonialism. The bit about the palm trees needing loads of water to be maintained, obviously saying that, like, the water should be used to just, you know, there's barely any water on this planet, so it should be used to just give to regular people. While the colonialists refuse to help the planet access more water was a nice touch. And then you see that in that scene with that, like, that Freeman person who's working for the Empire saying, you know, before they found spice, they were going to make, you know, loads of water here, and then they just decided not to. So I thought that was a nice touch. Reminded me of colonial green gardens in India. Also, the message about colonialists keeping colonies bad in order to extract the resources the most efficient way was cool. The Freemen were obviously inspired by Arab and Islamic cultures. They reference Paul as the Mahdi, which is obviously connected to Islamic sects in places like Sudan. I don't know if people picked up on that, but yeah, people... The Mahdi is a thing in certain Islamic beliefs. Basically, like, this figure who will come before the end times and stuff, like this chosen one figure like Paul. They're also pretty clearly inspired by the Bedouin nomads in the Middle East. So I don't know if you guys know about these people. You probably heard of them, but just like they are literally people who, just like in the film, live in the desert. Very like expert in traveling across it. There's been British explorers who've gone around with them. They also have a custom where if they meet a traveler on their journeys, they will give them food. And then there's a funny anecdote story of this British explorer. So he's like, we like killed some animal and then we were going to eat it for dinner. And then we bumped into two people who didn't have any food and we gave them the whole animal. And he said he was just so, so angry about that, but it's just their custom. But this gets to my problems. Paul at this point, remember I haven't read Dune, seems like a white savior. Sure, the Freemen aren't all on one ethnicity, but they do all look African, Middle Eastern, Mediterranean, so the racial divide seems apparent. Meanwhile, most of the colonialists in the film are white. If we are using them as a stand-in for European colonialism and the Freemen as native Arab tribes, then Paul being their Mahdi god figure is weird in this context. Again, I haven't read the book. It might change. You guys said that Dune overall is a criticism of this trope, so obviously, well, pretty much it is going to change, but, you know, who knows. Also, Chosen One stories are so overplayed now. I liked Blade Runner 2049 so much as it flipped the script and was like, spoilers for Blade Runner, if you really care about that, spoilers for Blade Runner, spoilers for Blade Runner. It's been out for 4 years. Spoilers, 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 spoilers. Just mute this for about 30 seconds. All right, that's your last chance. 3, 2, 1. So, also, Chosen One stories are so overplayed now. I like Blade Runner so much as it flipped the script and was like, well, you thought K was the first human-born replicant hybrid, but he's actually just another replicant. K becomes human by dying for a worthy cause. Other than that, I love how Villeneuve really takes his time to establish the world in his movies. I love the balcony scene in Blade Runner. In Dune, the scene where it introduced the worm properly was great, and I love how every payoff has a pretty organic setup. Yeah, so what I like about this film is that, like, it feels quite natural in a lot of ways. I know you do think, like, oh, it's going to come up again. But then when he's training with Josh Brolin at the start, it, like, shows that he is pretty good at, like, really close quarters knife combat, which obviously comes in at the end of the film where he showed to be good at it again. But then obviously you have little things like even him getting that compass thing from Duncan so he knows how to use it later and just, like, little things like that. Like, so I appreciate the setup. So, also on the world building, Philip K. Dick, Ridley Scott, and Villeneuve all did a great job of vague world building in Blade Runner. Dune does this very well too, gives you glimpses at the universe, but lets you imagine so much of it for yourself. Didn't want the film to end, and could watch a lot more of these, introducing a new sci-fi universe to the masses in this way. In a way that gets you so invested is really commendable. So, that's my general thoughts on the film. But yeah, I really liked it. Which, I don't say much about films, so... Okay, the spoilers are done. There you go, spoilers done, everyone. I'll take some comments. Robert Downey Jr. used to be a complete psycho, so. I need to watch Kingdom of Heaven Director's Cut. Apparently it's so much better, but I enjoyed the first movie. We actually did it a bit in my Crusades module at uni. Why it's way better than people think for the soundtrack. Yeah, Katie, I think it's like, for me, it's like with soundtrack stuff, I got a really particular taste. I'm just going to go on my movie soundtrack playlist. So, let's see what it looks like. So I got my synth playlist. And it's basically, this is my favourite playlist. So like, I just got 2020 synth. And then on the cover, you got Mr. Robot, Blade Runner, and Gone Girl. But Gone Girl is obviously done by Trent Reznor, who does loads of like these synth scores. But for me, I'm just like looking at it now. It's like Cliff Martinez, who was in Red Hot Chili Peppers, drummer, but he does a score for like Drive, basically every Nick Reffin film, like Neon Demon, what other films? Neon Demon, that Amazon series with him, then just like Vangelis and other people, really. But for me, I wouldn't really put like Dune in any of my playlists that do film scores. So I got my film score playlist and video game score playlist, and then I got like a general mix up of both of them. So the only one I got on this one that's video game is Death Stranding and some Metal Gear. And then on my general film playlist, have I got anything else different? I mean, on my general score players, I got like Witcher 3, some Watch Dogs in there, the Ubisoft one, loads of Assassin's Creed, some Far Cry, Westworld. What else we got in here? A lot of Westworld. Some Battlefield. Do you remember Spring Breakers? That's a good movie. That's got a good soundtrack, actually. Yeah, like Rogue One, I mean, like a lot of Star Wars movies have, it's different. Like you have like a good soundtrack sometimes, but then you have like something you'd actually stick on when you're relaxing. I tell you what did have a good soundtrack. Spike Jonze's Her with Joaquin Phoenix, because it was done by Arcade Fire, which is one of my favourite bands. But the visual language of the military stuff. Yeah, it was really cool seeing a sci-fi thing where there's like guns and missiles and bombs, but they're all fighting with swords. Like, it's a really interesting like contrast. They seem silly by accent. They're fucking weird as hell, but like, I appreciate them for sure. yeah, the David Lynch one, I might watch one day. The Sudanese Jihad. Yeah, that's so where I went to uni was where General Gordon was from. If we're talking about the Jihad against the British and the Egyptians. So General Gordon was a British general, and he was killed by like the Mahdi believers in Sudan. But the roads around my uni campus were named after him, and they were also named after the Sudanese capital and another city in Sudan as well, which was really weird for English roads to be named after Sudan. But then it's like, well, General Gordon is from this place, so it makes kind of sense, I guess. Skyrim, yes. Palm you. I have Skyrim soundtrack on all the fucking time, because when I'm editing, I have my TV, my big TV there, like 55-inch. There's so many Skyrim ambient, like playlist stuff, so just like images of the scenery and music. I have it on all the time. Yeah, it only works when you're watching the movies. Yeah, I wouldn't listen to it on my own. Oh, that's cool, Tristan. What club is it, if you don't mind saying? Yeah, Drogba used to play for, was it Arizona Phoenix or something? Or Phoenix Rising in Arizona, which was in the second division. Yeah, David, I that's something I did want to say. I recognise that, like, their religion has been, like, given to them by those witch people who manipulated... he's been manipulating everyone. Yeah, Dave Bautista was better in Blade Runner than he was in Dune, for sure. Have I watched Lord of the Rings? Of course. I used to be obsessed with Lord of the Rings when I was a kid. Yeah, with the sisters manipulating it. I can see that to an extent. But then it's like he's kind of embracing this trope. Detroit City FC. Oh, that's cool, Tristan. I've never heard of that. But yeah, it's a big step up. I wish the MLS had proper relegation and promotion. Khartoum. Yeah, it was called Khartoum, actually. That was one of them. One of the roads. There's a live Skyrim music channel. Oh, cool. I haven't seen that yet. What's your view on the politics of Dune, Cav? Yeah, Jack, did you tune out for a bit? Because you were here at the start, but then I did talk about it a fair bit. Are there any books I think would make a good movie? Well, the thing is, I really don't like fiction, generally, so I can't really say. What have I got on my wall? We have a couple fiction books. Yeah, to me, really, I don't really have many fiction books that I'd care for. What the people want in the comments is any famous ones that haven't been made into a film yet. Oh yeah, Jack. Basically, my view on the politics, but people were nice enough saying to me, I said in a thing, it seems like white savior, and it seems even worse than usual because the natives are clearly inspired by like the Bedouin peoples in Saudi Arabia and like people who believe in like the Mahdi in Islam. So it's clearly like very much like about European colonialism, and it'd be weird if Paul is actually like their savior. Obviously, we're talking about like the witch stuff as well. But people are telling me that like generally Dune, the book, has an anti-white savior message. So I'm guessing the film is going to be like that. So that kind of like reduces a lot of my criticisms with it. But in terms of like the anti-colonial stuff, I think it's nice and subtle, but like it's there. So like the palm trees in like their little like royal palace thing in Arrakis is cool. Because like these trees need like the water of five men every day. And obviously you can take that to any like hot place where colonialists would go and set up like these nice gardens and green places, India, Egypt. And it's not even just the British, it's, you know, it's also the French and other colonialists. So that's a nice little point there. And then saying, you know, about the extraction of the spice. And it's obviously like that lady says they could have made this into a paradise. They could have made all this water, but then they found the spice and it's more valuable. So the message about like keeping a colony like impoverished and bad so you can extract its wealth is something like we see everywhere. Like even the Iraq War is a perfect example of that. Like what do these European colonialist countries do in times of turmoil? They all come in and extract the wealth, or they'll use it as an opportunity. So yeah, like generally the politics, if people are saying the white savior stuff, if Dune is a generally anti-white savior thing as well, I pretty much don't have any problem with the politics. One thing I will say is a bit weird, and I could see people getting mad. It's kind of weird, and Blade Runner gets criticism for this, blending Middle Eastern Islamic cultures into one thing, because we already, but I know it's sci-fi, but we already have like a very stereotypical view of like that part of the world. So you're blending two groups of people essentially who probably don't have many similarities, and you've just made them into a new fictional thing. I don't know how people think about that because of the sci-fi element of it, but basically the criticism of the original Blade Runner, not really in the second one, but in the original one, it's like you've just made Asian culture where you've blended like Hong Kong and like other things together to something like really faceless, and there's no like nuance there at all. Like we don't know really what Asian culture we're looking at here, and there's not really like any people trying to delve into this. Whereas in the new Blade Runner, at least you have like Hungarian, you have, I think, what am I thinking of? There's a really specific, is it Mongolian maybe or something? I think Mongolian. And something else where it's like the Asian-ness of Blade Runner now is like, you can be like, oh, there's that, there's that, there's that. Where before it was like, this is Asian. Like, it's just oriented as Asian. Where the new one's like, very specifically, this is this, this, and this. Where I don't know what people think about Dune, where it's like, you're just putting Middle Eastern cultures and Islamic faiths into a blender and making like a very, very stereotypical group of people who don't often get to represent themselves in media. And although these people aren't actually, a lot of them, you know, I didn't see all the actors, but you have like Zendaya, who's mixed race. You have that guy who fights Paul, who's black. You have Javier Bardem, who's obviously Spanish, but he looks like, you know, he's Mediterranean, so he can pass for like types of like North African and stuff. So yeah, it's like, if I had to nitpick my problems, obviously I'm not from those parts of the world, so maybe people would say it's fine, but like, it's a criticism I see a lot at other like genres to do with more Asian cultures. But like, you know, we already think of the Middle East as a monolith, and the way we treat Muslim peoples, we always treat them like, well, if you're from Saudi Arabia or Sudan, you're the same. If you're from Algeria and Iran, you're the same because you're Muslim. And then taking those elements and like blending them together, I don't know what people think about that. Adrian, I haven't read the book, so I've already said before, I don't have the best perspective on the Messiah thing because I don't know how the story ends, basically. Yeah, the eugenics stuff, I said that to my girlfriend actually after it came out. I said it's obviously like a eugenics thing, like how Paul is created is basically eugenics, to make him like the best version or the most powerful version of this, like the one, the chosen one. Yeah, so people who've read the book, are the Freemen meant to be what I say they are? Are they meant to be like Benduin mixed with like other Islamic cultures, like people who believe in like the Mahdi and stuff like that? No, Francisco, I'm going to do the George Carlin video in the next couple of weeks. I've got some good ideas this week, which I want to do first. I think I'm going to come back and get Mr. Beast again on Wednesday or tomorrow. Okay, so it's not just the movie. And is this guy a white guy? Is he American? Yeah, Carrie, I like that bit about Stilgar as well. And it's like, it's basically like, you can be a good colonialist, you can be a bad colonialist, but like, you're still a colonialist at the same time. It's like, you know, they were bad, they were really evil viceroys in India. Viceroys are basically the leader of India when it was controlled by the British. And there were better ones who were nicer and stuff, but they were still colonialists, so it doesn't really matter. Yeah, Katie, I agree. Can we have multiple cultures that are based on multiple cultures instead of just one Orientalist amalgamation? Yeah, for sure. Yeah, you don't see many normal people. I guess that's fair enough. I look at this dude. It's not like the only normal people you see are some of like the Freeman women or something. Yeah, Last of Us 1 and 2 have good soundtrack, and he's going to do the show as well. Yeah, Jack Lucas. I'd be interested as well. Like, because some people said they left out some bad bits about Paul from the first bit, so. Have I read the book? No, I haven't read the book. I'm not going to read the book either. I'll read the, if I really like the films, I'll read them, but I don't want to spoil the films myself, so. Cav live stream on lunch break. You must be in like Australia, I'm guessing. I don't like anything. I like some things. I've seen your Chris Pratt video. It's pretty good. Thanks, Fabian. I don't think it's one of my best, but like, I just thought because he had controversy recently, we'd look into a bit more. Because everyone thinks he's such a nice guy, because he's funny, And yeah, maybe not. He used to mod Xbox controllers. Yeah, I saw that Timothy Chalamet. That's pretty cool, actually. It is problematic. Not like as bad as it first seems. I'd still call it Orientalism, though. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, the thing is, like, even if the movie did have the white savior trope, I still think it's a good movie. Like, even if you guys didn't tell me, it's kind of like, it's a criticism of that. And even, like, the Orientalism, it's like, you know, Blade Runner, the first one's one of my favorite films. I can recognize it does have kind of, like, a xenophobic undertone about Asian people in it and Orientalist stuff. The Freemen are Islamic and Zen Buddhist. Well, I guess I haven't really seen too much of them at the moment to know if they're Zen Buddhist, but the Islam thing's pretty apparent. They're based in Arabs. Okay. I have not seen the movie yet. The movie's good, though. You should go watch it. As it was written in the 60s. But was jihad as loaded a term in the 60s as it was, as it obviously is now, is an interesting one. I do wish for a media of a badass Native American fighting and winning against Western European knights. I mean, it was just like a fantasy thing because obviously that never happened. Although Native Americans did fight the Vikings. They documented that, which is quite interesting. It's kind of the point is you're seeing the Freeman from the Imperium's perspective, but yeah, planets, it's a problem with sci-fi in general, and was even worse back in the 60s. Well, the 60s could just get away with fucking anything in regards to like that sort of shit anyway. I like Argo, even though Ben Affleck is playing a Mexican-American. I mean, is he meant to be Mexican in the film, though? Maybe not as loaded. Yeah, the thing is, this is Halo fan. When I think about the 1960s and Jihad, the only thing I'm really thinking about is, like, the scars of the colonial period, and then also Israel and Palestine, and, like, maybe some more extreme elements in that conflict. Like, other than that, like, jihad has become such a loaded term these days. It's a lot different. Yeah, basically, existential dread. The Vikings, like Leif Erikson, went to North America and they had various conflicts with native tribes there, like various tribes. How they've worked out who they were is the Vikings would write about the boats, and if it was like a skin boat, like made out of animal skin, it was one tribe, and if it was a wooden boat, wooden canoe, then it would be another tribe. But yeah, they had some battles with them and stuff. It's pretty cool. I do really like that part of history. Yeah, Jack, there's like a vision bit in the film, but I don't know much about what happens, so. The orange Catholic Bible. Yeah, that's like an oxymoron for you. Yeah, if I used the term jihad in the movie today, yeah, probably would have. Yeah, the chosen one thing, that's why, like, I said spoilers before, but the chosen one thing, obviously Blade Runner kind of messes with that. But yeah, I'm just sick of chosen one narratives. Like, okay, you guys say that Dune might be a bit different, but like, even if we remove Dune from the equation, like Matrix, obviously like a big one, Lord of the Rings, Star Wars. The annoying thing about Star Wars is they did it again for the sequel trilogy. Like, why, like, is Rey this, like, chosen one again? I know she's not the chosen one, but she's, like, the granddaughter of, like, one of the most powerful force users in, like, the whole Star Wars universe. But Paul and Dune, don't spoil it for me. He is still like, not necessarily the chosen one, but he is like this point of eugenics where he could be, because he has like the political power and like the whatever that fucking thing he has is. David, I fucking hate episode 9, so... Wait, how long have I been streaming? Where does it say? Sorry. Bed, baths, and bong saying, I feel like Kavernacle should get some fire in his belly and become a debate bro he could decimate. To be honest, I mean, my girlfriend says this to me a lot. She's like, if you did that stuff, you'd be so good at it. And I would be good at it. I know I'd be good at it. I just don't want to do it. I wouldn't rule it out forever. Not being a debate bro, but I'll back myself and my political positions a lot. There's certain ones I really back myself on, like anti-colonialism, racism, like orientalism, foreign policy and stuff like that. Obviously stuff like Ireland and the UK. But the thing is with debate bros, what I hate about it is just there's just so much drama and... there's just so much shit going on. And then sometimes, like, I've said this a lot of times, but I get people, like, I see this drama on Twitter, and I'm like, who the fuck is this person? And then I look at it, they got, like, 5,000 followers on Twitch, and that's it. I'm like, why does anyone give a shit what this person has said? They're so irrelevant. And that happens, like, multiple times. It's like 5,000 followers, 2,000 followers, sometimes 10,000. And then they might have a bit of a bigger... Twitter presence or something, but it's like, what is all this drama about these fucking people? It's like that Mel stuff. Like, I follow Mel on like Twitter and I follow Vosh, so I've seen all this crap, and it's like, Mel is like someone who has like 15,000 on Twitter and like, and that's it, and like no Twitch presence and no YouTube presence, and people are just talking about them all the time, and it's like, come on, like. Is this what we should be focused on? To be fair, like, I don't focus, you know, my channel, I don't focus on the most important things all the time, I get that. But it's like, do I really want to just get into this stupid drama where, like, really minor people have fights with other minor people and then it becomes, like, a whole thing? I don't know. I think most debate bros are in it for clout, to be honest. And also, you know, I'm doing well with my own thing, so... Yeah, well, obviously, like, the houses are meant to be, like, European colonialists, it seems like, especially from the film. Yeah, that's fair enough, Olivia. Too few, I get that. It's kind of like old European monarchy style. Duncan, Idaho. Yeah, it's so fucking funny, man. Like, that name. Hey, Rachel. Thanks for joining. Yeah, episode 7's fine, but it's just so nothing. Like, at least the prequels, which I prefer anyway, actually do something new. Yeah, but isn't Xander Hall like literally say? Doesn't he? Isn't his like most watched video on YouTube saying he like used to be in the alt right or some shit? So. Yeah, Destiny's NFT thing is so fucking stupid. So quickly pivoting to Call of Duty quickly. Yeah, one sec. So I played and completed Call of Duty over the weekend, and basically the newest Call of Duty is set in World War II. Again, you might have seen it from the marketing. And I was actually surprised at how much... Okay, it's weird. I shouldn't be surprised or pleased with this, but like I actually am pleased that a World War II game acknowledged the realities of racism in the era. Like, it feels so weird to say that, but video games just don't really touch this stuff, really. So, for example, like... All right, so one of the... So you play as a squad of, like, different nationalities who are all, like, the best or whatever, and they're teaming up to stop the Nazis kind of, like, escaping.